Good morning, page 447, 447 in your hymnals, the banner of the cross. Let's all stand, shall we? Page 447.
There's a royal banner given for display.
I don't know if you're glad you're here. I'm glad you're here. Can we tell the Kim story?
Sure.
Kim has had a concern. She has something that they want a biopsy to see. We've all been through this, so listen very carefully. We were very concerned. She was very concerned. And so Wednesday night, she was going in Thursday, and they were going to do this, get it over with. She'd have some kind of, you know, relief. And so I'm not bragging. I just felt after church we prayed for her, but then I prayed for her after when Doug. So I said, let me know, Doug, let me know. Thursday, 3 o'clock, let me know what they say. Drama. This pause is drama. So he calls me and goes, the doctor's sick. They canceled her appointment. That would only happen to me. So she's going Tuesday. So you pray, right? Nothing big, just all of us, right?
It's mostly precautionary.
Exactly. But we want to. They want to make sure.
Amen.
But all of us have that tendency to go, I got a headache. It's my tumor coming back. Right? Or I bet it's a brain. I always do that, lay in bed. My stomach hurts. I've been poisoned. Finally, somebody got to my food, poisoned me to try and do me in. They got me. And then it's gone, and then I'm healed in the morning. You pray for her. Good to have you. Some of you are visiting for baptism. We're baptizing. We're baptizing. We're on the air, too. We are baptizing. Thank you, you wonderful people, for being with us today. The services of Lakeside Baptist Church. How's that? That my radio announcer voice? And well, we are baptizing. So if you can just give us a few minutes after the service, the message might even be longer than ever. But just give us some space and we'll get to it, okay? There are others, if you don't see them, they are probably sick. If you hear them cough, they're sick. If you hear them cough while we pray, move. They sneeze on you, yeah, wipe it off and move. We're going to, you know that hand gel, we're just going to get a big bucket, like when you dip water, we're just going to just, you're going to dip it and just kind of pour it over you and rub it in and kill all the germs. Ready to pray? Pray with me. Father, we give you this day. We ask you, Lord, to do in us what only you can do. Thank you for your word. And I know I am a messenger of the word. That's all I am. I know, Holy Spirit, you're the one that drives it home. Do that. Lord, there might be someone here today. I don't know. But if someone's here and not sure of their salvation, if someone's here and they've never trusted Christ to be their own Savior, then, of course, Lord, you want that more than we do. But I pray that you'd make that very clear to them. Thank you, Lord, for today. Thank you that you know what you're doing. Thank you that you're in charge. And we need to trust you. And I pray, Lord, that there are those maybe today couldn't be here, but they're watching through live stream. May you give them health. Take all the sickness away. Take all the germs. If they're recovering, I think of Rich Annis, Lord, just give him strength. And just work in him spiritually and physically. Thank you, Lord, that he's in remission. And thank you that you've done so much. Just please work there in his life. And Lord, I know that some are struggling with things that because they don't know the answer, it maybe has caused them to be obsessed. Just give them faith. Give them peace. You said, thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusteth in thee. Help me, Lord, to practice that verse. And maybe others today ought to do that. We give you all that we're about to do. Every song we sing, every special, every word that's preached, we give it to you. May you use it. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated.
Page 443, Sunshine in the Soul, 443.
Kind of awkward to me, because my life, I think he's mad. I don't know that he, I want him to smile at me. Do you? I want him to smile at me. We're glad you're here today. Let's do this. If you're visiting, we want to make sure that you get introduced. So let's start over on this side. Shelby, you want to introduce everybody? Wonderful. Wonderful. Good to see you again. Good to have you. Shelby's being baptized today. When she married Ryan, she discovered that she really needed religion.
Are they getting candy bars?
Huh?
Are they getting their candy bars?
I don't know. Did they make sure they get candy bars for being a first time? They already got them? Did you get them?
Some of them,
man. Are they the old ones? Give Brian the old ones. And that $100 bill that's taped to those. Oh, Era, you want to introduce?
My mom and dad, John.
Good to have, good to see him. Lincoln's getting baptized this morning.
Amen.
Look, for $10, I'll hold anybody under. Shelby's dad, Brian, already gave me 20. And he wants to pray while she's under. Who else? Anybody else visiting? Am I missing someone that's visiting? Is that everyone? Jeff's getting baptized today. And Jordan Grove is getting baptized today. So do we need to introduce Matt and Amy?
It's Matt and Amy.
And?
Little Matt.
He's like a sister. I can't wait for that camera up here showing you, because people can see this. Brandy's introducing her sister, Matt. Her sister, Matt. Her sister, Amy, Matt. So that's Matt and Amy. And?
Little Matthew.
Matt Jr. Ushers, you come. If you have a bulletin, you can see very quickly what's happening. Tomorrow, jail. Wednesday, midweek King's Kids Youth Group. Jail for the women on Saturday. Miller's on the 26th. That's there. Tonight, choir. There is choir, and we are baptizing. And then tonight, if you notice on the front side, if you're a teen or connected to a teen, there is an afterglow in the cafe tonight for the teenagers. So if you have any questions about that, you can check. Fred's doing better. Fred has been going through vertigo. They don't know why, but he hasn't worked. You haven't worked, but you're going back to work now finally. So keep praying for Fred. How many of you always thought Fred was dizzy? Chris? See her hand go up before I said, duh. God loves you, you know that. He loves you. Ready to pray? Pray with me. Father, thank you for what you give. Thank you that you know what's best for us. Help us to learn. Help us to see what you're trying to do. Help us to trust you and get close to you and just make sure we know, like Joseph, the Lord is with us. Thank you for this day. Thank you for the meaning of baptism. Thank you that it's such a wonderful picture. I pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you.
449. In your hymnals, the light of the world is Jesus. 449. Let's all stand, shall we? On the first verse, Junior Church and Primary Church, you may be dismissed.
The whole world was lost in the darkness of sin. The light of the world is Jesus. The sunshine at midday, His glory shall be. The light of the world is Jesus. Come to the light, it's shining for thee. Sweetly the light has gone upon me. Once I was blind, but now I can see. The light of the world is Jesus. In darkness have we in room Jesus a light. The light of the world is Jesus. We walk in the light when we follow our guide. The light of the world is Jesus. Come to the light.
Rebecca and Sarah are going to play a duet.
Thank you.
That was great.
Amen.
You know the chopsticks thing? I can do that. So when I hear that, I'm very impressed.
Amen.
Thank you. And they're just young little girls.
Yeah.
Huh? Remember when you were their age? 30 was old? Remember when 50 was old? Some of you are old. Matthew chapter 3. Here's what we're going to do. I got to warn you because I know what you're going to do. You're going to turn me off. You're going to mute me. Don't mute me. I'm going to talk about baptism. I'm going to talk about baptism because we're baptizing and we need to talk about it. We might as well talk about it when we're going to baptize. And you're sitting there saying, I know all about it. I've been baptized. I've read. I've heard about it. And I don't remember. I'm sorry. I apologize. I don't remember the line. I know I mentioned it, but I don't just talk specifically about it. But my goal is I've prepared and as I've prayed very hard, as everything, I never want anything to be a subject. I want it to be personal. So I'm hoping my prayer is, and I've taken some pains in my notes to make sure that you leave here at least with one bullet hole. You may not get the full blast, but I'm hoping that at least you say, man, that challenges me, and I want that. I don't want to just fill your head. We got enough big heads. We don't need more big heads. We need people living out what the Bible says. Talking to you. Talking to you. Matthew chapter 3. Here's how I'm going to do this. I call this, why was Jesus baptized? Why was Jesus baptized? Jesus was the Son of God, correct? Was he sinless? Did he ever sin? You sure? Couldn't. It wasn't that he was able not, it was that he was not able. There's a difference. There's a difference. He was all man. He was as much man as you could be, and he was as much God as God is. You say, I don't understand that. That's because you're not God. So you've got to read your Bible and believe that. But that's what the Bible is very clear on. When Jesus came, he came so that he could pay for man's sins as a man and as God. Correct? Follow before we read. Follow me now. Because you're going to get, I know you, I can see you. Some of you go, I'm listening. That's why we're getting the camera up there facing you so you can see what you look like. Because I can't explain it. You need to see it. And then we're going to take pictures off of it and post it on the bulletin board. Big ones. So you walk in and you see this. Jesus died not for his own sins, but he died for your sins. That's what I had a hard time with when I got saved almost 42 years ago. I had to see that he died for me. He didn't just die. He didn't just rise from the dead. He did that because my sins put him there. And so did yours. So I don't like to think about that. I don't like that. You better. So I want those, Lincoln's not here, is he? Did he go down? Jet went down. Shelby and Jordan, I want you to listen very carefully. I'm just talking to you. I'm not talking to anybody else. If you listen in and hear something, great. And I know, I told Christian and Stephen, I know they talked to Jet, and I know Jonathan, I know Era, and maybe Grandma talked to Lincoln about baptism, and it's not just getting wet. You know, it's fun. The guy, when we put that baptistry in, we had to redo it, and it was here, but it wasn't plumbed right. So the plumber, I'll never forget, said, hey, I'm going to put a heater in there, and you'll heat it up, and I'll put a jet. He said, if you want me to, I'll put a whole bunch of jets. It'd be like a hot tub. So I thought for a minute. I said, no, he better not. Y'all come in for church, and me and the boys and Amy are in the hot tub. That wouldn't look good. Forget about church. So there's just one jet with one T. One jet, and it's warm, and it's water, because it's just a picture. It's a picture. It's a picture of what Christ did and what you want everybody to know and that you're testifying of happened to you. Read this story with me. You'll read it silently. You can move your lips, but don't let any noise come out. Matthew chapter 3, verse 1. It says, in those days came John the Baptist. I asked my dad one time. I said, Dad, what do you think John the Baptist was like if he went to church? My dad goes, he'd go to the Catholic Church. I said, Dad, his name was John the Baptist with a capital B. If he was a baptizer, it'd be a small b. It's identifying, signifying who he was. It's capital John the Baptist. And when you go through the scriptures, you'll see where it says he baptized. It's not talking about, well, listen to me. I'm a Baptist on purpose. I didn't just go through the phone book and show up. There's a reason I'm here. There's a reason I believe what I believe. Not just the history of the Baptist, not just the doctrinal position of baptism. But all of a sudden you have this story where you have John the Baptist who the Old Testament said he would come, and then it was hundreds of years before he did. Then he did, and he was the one, the Bible calls him the forerunner. He was the introducer of the Son of God. Verse 1 says, chapter 3, says, in those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, or Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Verse 4, and the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey. The leathern girdle distinguished man from woman. The women would wear a robe that flowed. The men would wear this big diaper belt. But it distinguished them as being male, because the Bible talks about that. Talks about the dress and the hair. There ought to be... I'm going somewhere with this. There ought to be a difference. I'm kind of perturbed that nowadays they don't want there to be a difference. But there is a difference. The Bible's very clear. Whether you like it, whether you agree with it, whether you see it, God's right. He always has been right, and he always will be right. And you can fight with him as much as you want, but let me help you. He'll win. He'll win. There has to be a difference. It says that he ate locust, yuck, and wild honey. I love honey. Honey's good for you. I don't know how locust would taste. Maybe if you poured, maybe if you baptized the locust in the honey, they'd be kind of crunchy. Maybe the sugar from the honey. Someone said, what about chocolate-covered locust? Anything chocolate-covered is good. So I'd be willing to try it because the chocolate would match. So it says that he ate locusts and wild honey. Then, verse 5, then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan. Verse 6, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. They did that because they realized that that was going to be a picture of what Christ would do. John was preaching that message. The water didn't wash away anything. Remember when you were young? Girls didn't do this. Boys did. I did it. My boys did it. Take a shower? Yeah. Then you have to say this. Did you use soap? And you know what? How many times have we said, did you use soap? And they go, no. And so they went back. My mom would always say, I'd take a shower, and she'd go, did you scrub behind your ears? Why? So she would take her thumb and go, and then clean behind my ears. When she went to church when I was a kid, she wore gloves. That's how long ago that was, when they had horse and carriages, and she put on gloves, and she'd spit on her thumb, and then she'd wipe behind my ears like, what? Listen to me. The water of the Jordan River and the water in this baptistry, by the way, we pump this water from the Jordan River. Doesn't matter where the water's from. Doesn't matter. Well, it ain't about the water. It's about the picture. Verse 7, but, what's happening here? Up to verse 7, up to the but. What's happening? Here's what's happening. There are people that are seeing Jerusalem, Judea. People are flocking to John the Baptist. They're coming from everywhere. This guy's preaching, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and people are coming from all over. And look, they're repenting. And they're turning to God. They're turning from their sin, and they're turning to God. And John the Baptist in the Jordan is met. They're lined up. He's baptizing them in the Jordan River. Confessing, verse 6 says, confessing their sins. They need a Savior. They can't save themselves. Water won't do it. They've repented. He said that. So they've turned to God. And now they're making a public display of what's happened in their life. You can go all around the neighborhood. You can get saved. And you go to your neighbors and go, just want you to know I got saved. The neighbors are going to go, what? I don't care. Leave me alone. So when you're baptized, you're telling the people that care, us, what happened. Verse 7, but when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, my kind of guy, O generation of vipers. It's not a car. It's not a car. It's a sneaky snake. He says, O generation of snakes, you sneaky, crawly, poisonous, venomous killers. He said, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth, therefore, fruits meet for repentance. If you're going to be here, he said, you show that you've changed. Now listen to me very carefully before we finish reading. If Christ hasn't changed your life, then he's not in your life. You're nothing more than a viper. You can talk the talk, but if your life hasn't changed, you're a fraud. You're fake news. You're fake news. Not true. He says, bring forth, verse 8, bring forth, therefore, meets for repentance. And think not, verse 9, to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. It isn't who you came from. It isn't who you belong to. It isn't the fact that you're a Jew, he's saying now. Doesn't matter. He said, one thing's made. He said, now, verse 10, now also the axe is laid under the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Verse 11, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to carry, to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will throughly, not thoroughly, throughly, there's a difference. He will throughly, through and through, not around you, but through you. He will throughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Verse 13. How do you think those vipers took that? Not a pleasant message. They thought they were coming to a baptism. Then all of a sudden they get smacked around. That's called the truth. Everything that John said was truth. He wasn't trying to steer them wrong. He's trying to steer them right. And when they were steered wrong and he tried to steer them right, they didn't like it. Verse 13, then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him. I would. John forbade him, and he said, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Jesus answering said unto him, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him. Verse 16, and Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, verse 17, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. You know what that said to John? You better go ahead and baptize him, boy. So John dipped them under, brought them out. Pray with me. Father, I pray, speak to every heart. Don't let us think because we're baptized, we can't learn anything. Don't let us think that we're beyond your reach. Holy Spirit, you get down to that thing that we're hiding. You get right to that thing that we may deny or ignore, and you just pull it out and help us deal with it today. Thank you, God. Thank you for Shelby. Thank you for Jordan. Thank you for Jet. Thank you for Lincoln. Thank you that they're going to take a step to show what they've done. And then, Lord, they're taking a step to show what they're going to do. They're going to follow you. And we're going to help them so that they might bring forth meat for repentance, that we can see fruits in their life of their obedience to you. Lord, bless my words, help me to deliver it how you want. Give me your power, Spirit of God. I pray, and I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus, watch now. You got it. I'm going to give you the whole bundle right in the beginning, and then I'll ramble. So let me get out the important stuff first, then you can go back to sleep. Jesus came to John because he wanted to identify himself with what John was doing. John came on the scene. He went out into the wilderness. He told people that there's only one way God will let you in. He said, you need to repent. You need to turn from your sin, and you need to turn to God and let him save you. Let him get you into heaven. You can't do it. The Pharisees thought they could. So Jesus comes to be baptized by John the Baptist to be identified with the message of John. And not just John's message, but his baptism. God, you and I read, God and the Holy Spirit showed up. when Jesus was baptized. Jesus identified himself with mankind by coming to earth, by being born, I was going to say born of a virgin, born of a virgin, or born of a virgin. Do you ever have one of those? When Jesus came to earth, he took upon him, the Bible says, the likeness of man, so that when he died, God would be totally satisfied that he could pay for what you would do, because when he died, you hadn't done it yet. But he knew that sin that you committed yesterday, you don't think anybody knows about? He knew about it 2,000 years ago. He paid for it. That sin that if God tarries and you live another week, that sin that you'll commit on Friday, this coming week, I don't know what it is, but there's a sin that you're going to commit, even you don't know. Jesus knew about it when he died. That's how complete, because he's not just man, but he's God. And so he identifies by coming to earth, he identifies with mankind in every way, except how he was born. He was virgin born. No one was ever born like that. No one ever will be. The Bible says he was tempted in all points like as we are. He's endured because he's God. He knows everything you go through. When you sit there and pout and your lower lip hangs out and you whine, W-H-I-N-E, when you whine about life and I'm just going to eat worms, and if you're going to eat them, Bonnie's got them for sale. I'll pay for them if you'll eat them. I'm just going to eat worms. Life is so tough. Life is so unfair. Listen to me. Jesus has taken care of all that. He knew the struggle. He understands that. He never sinned. He couldn't sin. Was he tempted? Yes. Someone said, did he want to? I'm not going to answer that, because he's all man. If I say, I never want to sin, would you believe me? I'm a big fat liar, aren't I? I've never wanted to sin. So maybe the urge was there, but he couldn't because of who he was. He would have to experience that urge. Have you ever been tempted like that? Tempted to the point where, man, it was so hard. God, deliver me. God, help me. For Jesus to understand what you and I go through, he would have to be tempted to that point. But he didn't commit the sin. He couldn't. Amen. It was obvious after Jesus was baptized that he did it to be obedient to the Father. We talked in Sunday school about Jesus praying and saying, Father, I don't want to die, but if you want me to die, I don't want my will, I want your will. He experienced everything that you and I will ever experience. Baptism is for sinners. We have a requirement. You have to be a born-again sinner. We don't baptize sinners. We baptize born-again sinners. There's nothing, whether, and I'm not attacking anyone. I'll get hate mail. Because someone pours water on your forehead, your sins are not washed away, because sin is in your heart. They're going to pour it over their heart. The heart is deceitful, the Bible says, and above all things, and desperately wicked. Who can know it? You can't wash off sin by making the forehead wet. And you can't wash off sin by dunking somebody under. And even if we do hold them under and swish them around like a washing machine, that won't help. Jesus had no sins to confess. John the Baptist knows who he is. When he sees him, he doesn't ever ask who he is. He's the one in John chapter 1 who said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world." John knew who Jesus was. John felt that he would look better than Jesus if he baptized him. He said, "You need to baptize me." Did you see that? He said, "I have need." Verse 14, "I have need." That's how you get saved. You realize you don't have what you need.
Amen.
If you're here today and you think you have what you need to get into heaven, but that doesn't include Jesus, you don't have what you need. And I'm talking to those people that are going to watch this, okay? I'm talking to you too. But I want others to get this in. They need to get this in their brain. That when I came, I thought I had everything I needed. And when I read the Bible, and after 6 months of reading the Bible and hearing preaching, I realized I didn't have what I needed. John the Baptist said, "I have need. I have needs. I need you." John was admitting that he was a sinner. And Jesus said, "Just baptize me. This is the way it's supposed to be. I want you to be obedient to the Father. I'm going to show you how to be obedient to the Father." The Bible says he was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And here he is being baptized. Why? Because he needed it? No. To show why he came. Why did he come? To be a servant. And I want you to know, when you're being baptized today, and those of you who were baptized, every time you go to a funeral, here's what you ought to think. I'm going to die. I better be ready. Every time you go to a wedding, you better remember, better for worse, richer for poor, in sickness and in health. Don't you say, "I'm so hungry. I hope the food's good. Can't wait to get out of here. Hope the preacher doesn't preach long. Get it done, preacher. Get too much music. Let's go. It's hot in here." That's not why you're at the wedding. You're at the wedding so you identify with the fact that you said, if you're married, the same words. If you haven't said them, you're going to say them. And if you say them, you better mean them. And you and I, men, need to be committed to our wives. Better, for worse, for richer, for poor, in sickness, in hell. It's not something that they're going through. Good luck, sucker. That's not why we're there. We're there so that they can know that we like marriage, we love marriage, we're going to give it all we can, and we're behind them. Here's what I want you to do when we baptize. If you can't see, I want you to move up. We're not doing this just for God. We're doing this for you. If you need to spread out, if you feel like you need to come up here and won't block anybody, do that. We want you to be a part of this. This will be an encouragement. You being here, family coming, that encourages those who are being baptized. There are a lot of people that claim to be Christian, but too few of them live any differently than the rest of the world. "I wish water changed you. I'd leave the water in and take a dunk every day. But it isn't the water. It's what the water means. The water means when I get in the water, my old man, I'm leaving in the water. And I'm coming out a new woman or man. I'm coming out a new person. I'm going to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God." The real issue about being baptized is, has God changed your life? I don't remember my baptism that well. It was a long time ago. But I know I did it, and I know that I was being faithful, and I know that I was challenged to be a different person, not because I could, but because God was working in my life. When you're really saved, there'll be evidence of it.
Amen.
You'll want to know more about Christ from His Word. You'll hate sin. You'll desire for the Lord to be pleased in everything you do. Saving faith is never alone. Listen to me. saving faith is never alone. It always brings obedience to Christ. You know the question I get asked? I'm getting up into the old pastor category. So the young, most of these guys, that most of them are younger, they'll say to me, can I ask you a question? And I'm just hoping it's not deeply theological, because I'm not deeply theological. And they'll go, do you spend a lot of time chasing sheep? The ones that ought to be there, do you spend a lot of time trying to round them up? I said, yeah, too much time. They ought to know better. They ought to be doing what they promised to do. They ought to be good sheep. Do you understand what I'm saying? The Bible always shows a close connection between what you believe and what you do. If you really believe it, you'll do it. I see people that don't come, they go, oh, yeah, I'm supposed to be there. They don't miss work. They don't miss ball games. They don't miss picnics. They don't miss vacations. God always gets put on the back burner. Listen to me, I'm telling you something. Baptism isn't just getting wet and going through because I'm being obedient to Christ. When you turn to Christ by faith, He forgives you of your sin. And baptism is the outward act that demonstrates what Christ has done inside of you. And if you don't live like Christ has changed you, then something's wrong. Two simple points. Ready? I'm mocking Stephen. Mock me. If you were here Sunday night, he mocked me. By the way, if you didn't see the Costa Rica trip, it's online. If you get online, that service is on there. It came out very good. If you want to see it, you got to watch that. Two points. Number one, baptism and faith are separate. Baptism and faith are separate. They're not the same thing. You know people, I know people that believe that when you trust Christ, you have to be baptized to be saved. That is not biblical. When you're baptized, you're confessing your faith in Christ. Verse 6. It says they were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. That means they took the whole blame for their sins. That means they realized there's nothing I can do. They're all mine, and I don't know what to do with them. But Christ came, and he died, and he paid for my sins. Thief on the cross. Did the thief on the cross go to heaven? When he said, Lord, remember me, and Jesus said, today you'll be with me. Did Jesus say, but first, man, you need to figure out how to get baptized? No, Jesus said, today. Amen. Today you'll be with me. You get to heaven, some people can't get baptized, but if you can and are, you better, I'll leave the water in the tub. You better do what the Lord wants you to do. When you're baptized, it's a picture of having your old life left in the water, and you come out to live for Christ. When you trust Christ, you're personally responding to what He did for you by paying for your sins on the cross. And if you don't talk about sin or claim and admit that you're a sinner, then Christ didn't have to die. That's popular today. The message today is don't make anybody feel bad. Don't offend anybody. Don't make anybody admit they're a sinner. Well, the Bible says you can't get to heaven. I'm concerned. Man, you've got these great big churches. They're baptizing all these people. But I ask these people, will you believe you're a sinner? And they go, well, everybody's a sinner. I'll say, well, wait a minute. You were baptized, but do you believe you needed Christ died for you and that his payment was enough? And so you turn to him and, well, you know, the baptism completes that. No, it doesn't. Many will say to me, in that day, Lord, Lord. The Bible says in the last days that many will turn their ears from the truth. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. Jesus came to take our punishment. He lived a perfect life. He had no sin of his own to die for. He was all man, could be our substitute. He was fully God, and he could kill death and rise from the dead. And you can't turn to God without turning from your sin. Jesus Christ paid the penalty that you and I deserve. Look up here. Look up here. There's a ring on that finger. You see it? it won't come off. If it would come off, I'd still be married. Right? I have this woman that I gave one to that will remind me. So she prayed that God would stick this ring on my finger and not let me get it off, because it won't come off. She takes hers off all the time, you know, lays it down and loses it, and it goes in the garbage disposal. But mine, it's there. I mean, it's all dented and three diamonds in it, still there. She goes, I can't believe the diamonds are still there. And I said, well, I don't really do anything, so there's no reason they'd fall out. Follow me. My wedding ring doesn't make me married. I could have got married without a ring. Some of you did. Some of you had a cigar band. You ever hear that story? Oh, I couldn't afford a ring. You know, the big thing now is rubber rings. Have you seen these? Now you buy a rubber ring. Cheapskate. I spent a fortune. 39 years ago, man, I went out to E.H. Tepe. I spent a lot. I'm still paying on it. I didn't buy a rubber ring, a rubber band, a glorified rubber band. I love you. Listen to me, though. Listen to me. Not about the ring. You can get married without a ring. In fact, you can wear a ring and not be married. Marriage is based on commitment. The wedding ring is a symbol of the truth that you're married. My ring tells the women of the world that I'm not available. I'm committed to my wife. And that's what baptism does, folks. Listen to me, baptism tells the world that you're no longer available and you're committed to Christ. Now I want you to think about that today. First point, baptism and faith are separate. Second point, say, oh brother, you just hold on. Second point, baptism matters. Say, well, that's not very theological. Well, you can't understand anything deeper than that. That's why I'm keeping you in the shallow end. Baptism matters. It tells the Lord that you love Him and you're willing to obey Him. It encourages others in the church. And it's a public testimony of your faith in Christ. Verse 17, a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." God delights in baptism. When we do the Lord's Supper, if you've ever been here for the Lord's Supper, it's a big deal to us. For 30 years, I've never rushed through it. For 30 years, I've never said, well, here, drink it, eat the cracker. You know what it means. It's a big deal. We make a big deal out of every one of them. Baptism is a big deal. Baptism's the start of being identified with God. Those being baptized today, you're identified with God. You're not identified with the world. You're not identified with anybody else. You're identified with God. It's all about Jesus. The crackers and the juice that we drink when we do the Lord's Supper, not about the cracker. I've had people say, can we get different juice? How about the juice? One year I had Amy when we were very, very small. She would make pie crust. And then people would say, can we have some Cool Whip? Would that be wrong to have Cool Whip? No. That's not what it's about. So now we've gone to crackers. Crackers and juice. Why? Because that water isn't about the water. It isn't about who's in the water. Take all the pictures you want. Won't bother me. But I'm telling you, baptism is all about Jesus. He came to die. He's the one that died. He's the one that went to hell for us. And He was buried. And He rose from the dead for us. It's all about Him. We baptize to remember what Jesus did for us. If your life has not been changed, it's not God's fault. He's done everything He needs to do. You need to ask yourself this morning, would you please? Would you please? We're going to have a very quick invitation. You need to ask yourself, my life changed. Maybe you've never been saved. Maybe you've never trusted Christ. Hey, don't cut. You see my Bible closed, all of you kick into let's go mode. Hold still. Don't put your shoes on yet. If your life hasn't been changed, it isn't the guy that baptized you's fault. The water's warm. I've had to baptize in the cold. It's terrible. It's warm. It's somewhat clean. We leave it a little dirty. Baptism is about Jesus. You are saying today, if you were baptized a long time ago, this is what you said when you got baptized. Remember this. This is what you said. I'm dying to my old life, and I'm coming out a changed person to be obedient, to live for God. Can you really say? You say, well, I'm not living for God. Do I need to get baptized? No. You need to decide to live for God. You need to say, my baptism said that. I need to live up to what I told people, that I was going to live for God. I'm going to let God change my life. Hey, thank God. I'm a sinner, but God has changed my life. He did what I could never do. Because I try to be good. I make it about 2 seconds. Then I fall. But God has done things in my life. Only God could change me and cleanse me and do what he did in my life. Nobody else could. Nobody else could. Here's what I want you to do. When we have the invitation in a minute, if you need to pray right where you're at, we'll give you an opportunity to come. Has God changed? You need to ask, has God changed my life? Have I let him? Have I been obedient to him? Your head bowed, your eyes closed. The pianist is going to come. Your head bowed, your eyes closed. Dear Lord, we need you. You told John the Baptist, hey, baptize me. John said, I need you. I have needs. I shouldn't be baptizing you. Make me look better. Jesus just said, hey, just do it. Suffer it to be so. Because this is how we're going to fulfill all righteousness. Dear Lord, there are people in this room. You know their life isn't what it ought to be. You're the only one that can make it what it ought to be. Help them to quit trying on their own. Help them to just surrender and submit to you and allow you to change their life. If there's anybody here that's not saved, Lord, make them aware of that. Help them to see they're a sinner. They'll never get to heaven without Christ. Your head bowed, your eyes closed. I don't want to miss the opportunity. You may say, preacher, I'm not saved. I've never trusted Christ. I don't know for sure right now that I'd go to heaven when I die, but I want to know that. I want to know when I die, I'll go to heaven. Preacher, would you pray for me? I won't point you out. I won't embarrass you. I promise. I'll just thank you if you raise your hand. You say, preacher, would you pray for me? I'm not saved. I'm not sure I'm going to heaven when I die, but I want to know that. I want to know that. I want to know that. Your head bowed, your eyes closed. If that's you, just slip it up. Preacher, I want to know I'm going to heaven. I want to know. I want to know. I want to know. You say, I know I'm going to heaven. We've switched gears. Preacher, I know I'm going to heaven. I know God has saved me. I remember asking him to save me. Preacher, I remember getting baptized. Has your life really changed like it should? Have you really let God take over? Have you really submitted to him so he could do in you what only he can do? Do you just look good? Do you just sound good? Or have you really changed? God has spoken to you this morning. Your head bowed, your eyes closed. You say, preacher, God is speaking to my heart. There's something. Maybe there's a big thing, maybe a little thing, maybe a couple of things. Say, preacher, God's speaking to me about something in my life. I want you to know that. Here's my hand. God's speaking to my heart. If that's you, slip it up. Thank you. Others, pray for me. Preacher, God's speaking to my heart. God showed me something. If that's you, slip it up. Preacher, God, there's something in my life. I gotta let God take care of it. I gotta let God. Last call, preacher. Here's my hand, up and down. I'm watching. I'm gonna just slip it up, take it down. Preacher, God is speaking to my heart. He's speaking to my heart. Dear Lord, we give you these moments that you might show us what we should do, that we would admit, like John the Baptist, I'm not worthy at all. There's nothing in me. But it's you. And so, Lord, show us that whatever happens in our life, good, you did it. If we're bad, we claim that. But if we're good, it's you. Please work in our lives today, I pray. In Jesus' name. Piano's going to play. You're standing. Would you stand? Just, if you can, get up quickly. If you're going to come, come on. If you just want to pray where you're at, if you just want to come up to the altar, talk to God about something, do that as she plays. Come on, come on. If you're being baptized, I need you up here on the front row. If you're being baptized, I need you up on the organ side. There's room. Just squeeze up here and just stand up here a minute, would you please, before you go to change. Just come up here and stand on the organ side on my left. Time just for you, right up here at this pew, right at this pew. Be nice if water changed your life. It doesn't. But when you really get baptized, you really pray for these guys, pray for the young ones, that they understand what's happening here. Help them to lock into this, and then from here on out, realize it's time to do what God wants, time to be obedient to Him, go on the path He wants me to go. Father, may you be glorified in our lives. Show us what we're hiding. Show us what we're refusing to confess. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Hey, y'all, hold on. They're going to help you. Lincoln, you're first, just so they know that. Then Jet, then Jordan, then Shelby. If you need to move, move. If you need to get a picture or whatever, we're going to record everything. But if you need to get a picture, do that. When you get in the baptistry, come straight up the steps, face that way. Go like this. I'll do the rest. Okay? Ready? I'll meet you there. Thank you. John's coming.
Page 43 in your hymnals, Nothing But the Blood, page 43.
Oh,
hymnals, page 50. There is power in the blood. Brady, would you let me know what you're on there? Put your hands up like this. Ready? Lincoln, what's your last name? I'll make sure. Gotta stand. Just stand, okay, and then I'm gonna dip you under. Because you trusted Christ, and you did. Jesus is your Savior. You're going to heaven, right? Because of what Jesus did. You're getting baptized because He died and was buried and rose from the dead for you. Do you believe that? Amen. So I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Don't swim. You're getting this, aren't you? Pretty dress. Pretty dress. Like this. I'm going to help you back. Jet Ruley, you my grandson. It's an honor to baptize you. You trusted Christ. I remember when you did. I remember it changed your life. That's exciting to me. So because that's happened, you're following the Lord. You're being obedient. So you're being baptized. So because of that, Jet Ruley, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We practice in the pool, so you wouldn't know it, though. Ready? What's my dress? Face that way like this. Jordan Grove, how exciting. You trusted Christ. It's changed your life. We could tell there's something different. So because of that, you want to be baptized and follow the Lord. Mm-hmm. Want me to plug your nose?
I don't care.
I may. Okay. Because you've trusted Christ, Jordan, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Nice, isn't it?
I know.
Warm.
It is. Yeah.
Shelby Kiefer, you got baptized a long time ago, but you didn't remember, right? Is that what you told me?
You haven't been baptized.
Maybe that's someone else. So you've never been baptized, but you know you should be.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why you're doing it. You heard what I said this morning?
Mm-hmm.
And Ryan said it's okay?
He said it's okay. Although he doesn't have much choice in this matter.
But you want to follow the Lord.
Yes,
so you're doing it now. You're starting. This is a good start. So because of what you've done, whatever you did it, you trusted Christ, you know you're going to heaven. Because of that, hold on, I'm going to plug your nose.
Please. Okay?
Because you've trusted Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. I'm going to pray. Then you can wait for them or do whatever you want to do. Pray with me. Father, thank you for the picture that we've seen today. We've heard about it. Now we saw it again. And we know that it honors you. We know that when your son was baptized, you couldn't keep quiet. You spoke from heaven. Thank you, Lord, that we can follow you. Thank you that we can be obedient to you. Help every one of us to leave here today more determined to obey you and follow you. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.